So we probably should get started today. So if you remember those few of you over here on Friday, or those who put up over the weekend, we just talked about the closed graph theorem. So let's just So we're just going to map x to y, x, y are Banach spaces, and if just any linear map, and if it's continuous, if and only if the graph there is closed. That whole phrase there, we just say f is closed. And one direction here is really obvious. If f is continuous, then the graph is closed. That's just a fact about topological spaces. And the inverse is the thing that you need to repeat in the data. Okay. And then we gave this really cheap proof of the grounded inverse theorem. Let's do one more example application of it, which is similarly maybe feels a bit cheap. So if x, again Banach space, has closed subspaces y and z, such that every x in x has a unique decomposition x equals y plus z, where obviously little y is anything y and z is anything z. Okay, the thing that we might ask here is, well, in that case, is x equivalent to y to x sub z? And so, at the level of vector spaces, yes, I mean, that's what it means to say that every x in here we can write uniquely as something in here plus something in here. But if we're talking about Banach spaces, we want something more, because this has a norm, just the whatever the norm of x was. But here, y plus z, y to x sub z, has a norm, so the norm of y plus z, I think we talked about this at some point when we took direct sum of Banach spaces, the norm, which is the norm of two elements. So we need to check that the two norms here are equivalent in that sense, that they're a constant side of the direction that compare. Okay. Well, of course, the norm of y plus z, thought of as an element of x, is of course bounded by the triangle inequality, by the norm of y according to x plus the norm of z according to x. Okay, but that's just exactly the norm of y plus z in this direct sum space. Okay, that was the this was the definition of this right hand side, and that's the triangle. So we get one direction nice and easily. Okay, but it's maybe not obvious until you have the closed graph theorem how to use the other way. So then, the point is that we can just consider, and we're sort of, is this pretty similar to the bounded inverse theorem, I guess. I guess we need to see both the bounded inverse theorem at this point. So, the map back makes Maybe this idea would have been clearer if... let me do this better. Let's just change notation for our elements of the direct sound. Let's just write these as ordered pairs. Okay. Well, yeah, let's write this as an ordered pair. Okay. And I think maybe it's a little bit clearer. What's going on? So then the math back, sending the pair y, z to the sum of those two vectors in x. So what do we have? So maybe that's not the math that I want to do. So this is just the inverse. So what we just did was prove that that this map is bounded. Okay, that inequality there is a bound. It's the same the image. The norm of the image is the most the norm of what you started with. Okay, thus has bounded inverse. And so that tells you there exists some number c. We get exactly this inequality the other way around now. So that the norm of the inverse map, so that's saying that the a point over in the image, its norm according to that norm is inverse of c times the norm of y plus c. According to this. And so, in fact, the two norms really work. Is that okay with everyone? It's a little bit strange to get your head around, maybe, that there really are two different norms to go. Okay, so another corollary, which we're not actually going to use as far as I remember in the remainder of the notes, but nevertheless, it's sort of considered one of the big three things about Banach spaces. The uniform boundedness principle, the closed graph theorem, near the mapping theorem. So it's a bit evil to tell you two and not the others. Okay, so first of all, the definition, and just a map between topological spaces, is open. If f of u is open, whenever u is open, so it's a likely condition for being continuous, but pointing in the other direction. So here the open mapping theorem says continuous onto maps, well, linear maps, between Banach spaces. So, what do we do? So, if we've got f from x to y continuous, kernel of f is a closed subspace of x. And as we talked about, and we'll discuss more in the tutorial this afternoon, we can look at x mod the kernel of f, and this is a Banach space. If you remember when we talked about this earlier last week, I told you what the norm on a quotient space was meant to be. It was that infimum over the norms of all representatives of a coset, but we didn't prove that it was complete with respect to that norm. It's still something hanging over us. We get obviously then some other map, changing my letters, f tilde. The point is a map. map out of X descends to a map out of the Cauchy-Gordan kernel. And this one is now a continuous vector. It's a bijection, it has a continuous inverse, that means the map itself is open, okay? Just because of the, think about what open and what continuous means, it's just changing the F for F inverse there. So therefore, F tilde itself is open. Finally, we wanted to say that the quotient map from X to X mod the kernel of F is open. Easily immediately from the definition, compositions of open maps are open. So how do we see this? Well, we really have to actually go and think about the norm that we put on this quotient to even better say this. So let's just point out something about open maps. Let's just say differently. In a metric space, being open means that for any ball, source space, there's an open ball sitting around T of X. Sitting inside the image of that ball we start. Okay. Hopefully that's just a matter of unpacking what it means to be an open set in a metric space. Every point is an open ball around it. That. So we just need to work out what's going on here. So say we have Bx delta sitting inside our source space X. Our job is to produce some open ball sitting in the image of the quotient space. But the point is, I think that hopefully, hopefully what's going on here I'm not so sure, let's see if this works. Hopefully so this is the ball, let's wrap where we meet the ball. This is the ball in X mod the kernel of F. Oh, sorry, and I changed from T to F. Instantly sentence. Let's change it back to F. So why is that true? Write out the definition of this metric. So this is all the points that look like y plus kernel of f such that the infimum taken over all z and the kernel of f of the distance between f of x and y plus z is less than delta. Okay? That's just the definition of the what a ball in the quotient space looks like. So just this infimum here is just the distance function on that kernel. Now what do we do? Something's horribly wrong. Something's definitely horribly wrong. What am I doing? Yeah, that's okay. I'm being completely stupid. What if, why can you tell the reader that I'm being completely stupid? But what if it on the board doesn't even type check? Yeah. They're just balls in completely different places. I'm just going off the rails here. So why does this work? What am I doing? So let's see. Because we're not talking about F anymore. F's gone away. We're thinking about this map here. So I think I was on the right track, that the ball that we're meant to produce to show that this map is open is meant to be pretty much the ball that we started with. So let's call this map Q. And now let's write things a bit more sensible. So here we're in X mod the kernel of F, and we're trying to show that this. Okay. So now everything is in the same place. This is some ball in X mod the kernel of F, and this is also some ball in X mod the kernel of F. So where are we now? This is the set of all Y plus something in the kernel, where this infimum of the distance from X minus Y plus Z is less than delta. Does that look sensible now? Maybe we just need something weaker. Maybe we should just try and prove that, since that's all we need to prove. Then this is going to work. So say we've got a point in here, okay? And let's actually, why don't we make life a little bit easier even? Let's give ourselves a bit more room. Might as well. Y plus the kernel of F is in this set. Okay. So that means that this infimum is less than delta over 2. So pick some Z. I didn't need to divided by 2, better less than sign here anyway. So pick some particular Z. So the norm of X minus Y plus Z is less than delta. Okay? And so now we just need to see that that we can now exhibit a point over here. And what do we do? Thank you.
y plus the kernel of f is in q of here. So we need to pick some point, so we need to produce some point that was close to x. Oh, I see, we can just pick y plus z. Yeah, okay, so, okay. So let's erase that and just say what we've said. Okay. So thus, y plus z is in that ball. That's exactly what we said there. And so that's saying that y plus the kernel of f is in q of that ball. Okay. Sorry, it's very simple, but I managed to make it look very hard. Okay. So the quotient map itself was open. The map from the X mod quotient was opened by the bounded numbers theorem, and bringing together we got a result. Okay, I should edit the notes so that this easy step is made explicit for next time an idiot like me tries to read the notes and explain what's going on. An interesting thing about these three theorems, the uniform Gardiner's principle, the closed graph theorem, the open mapping theorem, is that you can actually prove them in basically any order you like. So one thing this means is that if you don't like the explanation that I've given in lecture, which is the one that's in the notes, and you want to look up some other book to understand what's going on, you will probably find a completely different proof, because maybe they'll prove the open mapping theorem first, and then prove the other two as corollaries of that. But that's both a good thing and a bad thing. I mean, it's good because by seeing all the different versions, you can maybe really understand what's going on. Okay. So, the next thing that we want is the Hahn-Banach theorem, which, as we'll see in the last week or two of the course, is actually useful and helps you do things like construct solutions of differential equations. But it sort of has a bit of a strange formulation at first. So let's... what we're going to do is state the version that we actually care about for complex Banach spaces, then state a stupid version for real Banach spaces, then prove the stupid version for real Banach spaces, and derive the one for complex Banach spaces from the one for real Banach spaces, okay? But it's this first one for complex Banach spaces that that matters. So here, so the X, the complex Banach space, Y and X, subspace, and phi, just to find a y, a bounded near function. There exists phi prime on the whole Banach space, whose norm is exactly the same as the one we started. Oh, sorry. And of course, phi prime restricted to y is equal to phi. So that is, we can. This is just saying that anytime you have a bounded linear function, you can always extend it to the rest of the space you're working on. Okay. So here's the somewhat unfortunate version that we'll actually prove first. So first of all, a little definition. A gauge function on a real vector space within that P from real vector space to the real numbers. So it's not a linear map at all, but it satisfies something sort of like a triangle inequality instead of linearity. And P of alpha x is alpha times P of x for alpha, a non-negative real number, non-negative real number. Okay, and just the things to think about here are certain linear functionals are gauge functions, because this is just inequality, and that's true for all scalars. But
But another example is the norm. That's the triangular inequality now, and that's homogeneity of the norm. And a third one is positive linear combinations. Particularly, you can take the norm and you can add to it any linear functional or subtract from it any linear functional because subtracting a linear functional is like is the same as adding the negative of that linear functional just to a gauge function. Okay, there's that. And so here's the, that's the end of the definition, the examples of them. And so then we say that P be a gauge function. Real vector space X let phi be a real linear functional if you write linear somewhere on a subspace Y with the property that phi is bounded by the gauge function. Restricted to y in phi, and still phi prime of x is still bounded by the gauge. So what have we done here? We've done a few things. So first of all, actually, there's no topology whatsoever in this statement. Okay, this is just a real vector space. It doesn't come equipped with a norm or anything. We're doing all of our control by controlling things by some arbitrary gauge function. But we're not, because there are gauge functions that aren't just the norm, sort of, we've got ourselves a bit of extra flexibility in this version. But it's about real vector spaces, not about vector spaces. Okay. So it's all, this one is a bit of a strange statement. Something else to say? Okay, so let's prove two and then prove one. And the proof comes in, part two comes in two very distinct parts. One that just says, you can always extend your function phi to a vector space that's just one dimension bigger. That is, you can take something outside of y, look at the span of y and that new vector, and then extend phi to that, so that all these conditions still hold. Okay? And then there's a Zuhn's lemma argument that says that you get what you want, an extension all the way up to all of x. Do you guys know you guys have all heard the thing that people say about the axiom of choice, the well-ordering theorem, and Zuhn's lemma? So does everyone know what the well-ordering theorem is? So that it says that on any set, you can produce a well ordering, which means a total order on the set, so that every subset has a least element. The obvious counterexample of this is the real numbers. There's obviously no total order on the real numbers, but every set has a least element. That's why we're learning about infimums in the first place. So the thing that people say is that the axiom of choice is obviously true. The well-ordering theorem is obviously false. Zuhn's lemma, well, who can tell? Okay. But we'll use Zuhn's lemma. So here's the honest part. Oh, proof of two. Okay. So take some point z naught. Outside of the subspace that we're already defined on. Of course, if there isn't any such z naught, then we're just done. And we do the following trick. So first of all, without loss of generality, can actually assume p is zero on y, and p is non-negative on y, and the way you do this is just by subtracting phi off. Itself and from people.
Okay.
That's not what I wanted to do at all. You need to be a little bit clever than that. What I said made no sense. You can't just subtract phi off, because phi is only defined on y so far, okay? And so it's not clear what would even mean to subtract phi off from p outside of y. So we need to go a little bit better. So first, define. Z plus t times z naught, because z is in x, z naught is this new vector you picked, just to phi of z. And so this is defined on the span of x and z naught. Upset about this still. Oh, it's okay. So maybe let me say this again a little bit more clearly. So in the honest part, we just try to extend phi to the span of x and z naught. And so for the purpose of this bit of the problem, we can just completely ignore any bit of the space, the span of y. Yeah, that's also the span of y. Yeah. So while we're working here, we can just completely ignore anything outside of this span. Okay. So we're just thinking now about phi being defined on y and p being defined on the span of y, z. There's just nothing else outside. So it really does make sense to define this thing on that span and then subtract that from both whatever phi we started with and whatever p we started with. And then, of course, because phi and phi prime are just identical on y, our new phi is actually just zero and p is saying p is non-negative because, of course, when we subtract off phi, our condition becomes that zero is less than equal to it. Okay. So we have the following little fact. If you look at p z double prime, because z double prime is just anything, plus p z prime minus z naught, that's bigger than p of z prime, so z double prime plus z prime, and that's bigger than zero. So all that we're using here is the fact that p was a gauge function using the triangle inequality there, and that's for any z prime, z double prime. Okay, let's be careful where in the space y. Okay. So, in particular now, we can just forget about the middle bit, and so we can say p of z double prime plus z naught is greater than or equal to minus p of z prime minus z naught.
prime is set null. And that's just true for still true for arbitrary z prime and z double prime. And thus, if we look at a quantity beta, which we'll take to just be the infimum of this guy, so it's the infimum over all choices of z double prime, p of z double prime plus z naught. The point is that this infimum is strictly bigger than negative infinity, okay? Because every point in this infimum is bigger than this, however we picked z prime. We did this inequality here just to make sure that this infimum is fine. Okay. Now, in fact, better. I mean, the point is that beta is greater than or equal to negative p z prime minus z naught for any z prime. So now we can say what we want the extension to be. Some arbitrary point in this new spanning set to just be t times beta. Okay. So this is obviously a linear map defined on the span of y and z naught. And what we can do, so it's obviously a linear map, and it obviously extends the original phi. T is zero, this is just zero, and so that agrees with the original phi on y. But we still need to check that this thing still satisfies the gauge condition, that is, it's still less than p. So we have to do this in two pieces. Obviously true when t equals zero, and so then let's break into cases according to the sign of t otherwise. And here we can look at p prime of z plus t times z naught, and of course that's just t p. And now just use that inequality just here for beta, and see that. So don't use that inequality. Use the fact that beta is an infimum. Okay, so in particular, beta is less than anything of that form, and so in particular, we can say it's less than. Beta. And now we use this inequality, but because t is negative now, when we multiply through by t, that flips the inequality over, and we get that's less than minus t, and now p, and now we can put in any z prime we like, so we just use the same one. I better get the sign right there, minus z naught. We don't pick the same z prime, we pick minus z over t. And then minus t is a positive number, so you can pull in this f of t. Okay, and so that was exactly the condition. Our extension still satisfied the gauge condition. That seem okay? So here, this is, maybe I should just mark two inequalities here that we're using, because it's a bit strange. This trick we used one inch. So the first time we used the first one, and the second time we're using the second. Sorry. I put this in completely the wrong place. I should have put that over there. Okay, sorry. The first time we were using the beta was bigger than anything, so that's great. Okay. Good, okay. And so then after that it's almost lambda for the win. What have we done so far? We've shown that if you've got some linear functional that's smaller than the gauge function on some subspace, you can always extend it to a one bigger dimensional space. So here we just let P consist of all the pairs Z comma psi, where here Z is a subspace containing Y, and C is an extension of phi, with C still less than our gauge function. Okay. Now, this is a partially what it said. So we say that Z comma C is less than Z prime comma psi prime, just if Z is the subspace of Z prime, and the linear function on the big subspace just restricts the linear function on the small one. Okay. So you're less than exactly if you're a compatible extension, if the other one is a compatible extension of U. Now any chain so that just means some totally ordered subset of this P. Okay? So some subset of these P's where any two things, one is definitely bigger than the other one, any chain Z alpha psi alpha has a maximal element. So because these guys are all ordered, the Z alphas are actually just sort of an indexed increasing sequence of subsets. You can just take the union of all the Z alphas, just take, I'm not sure what the right thing to, you can just have a linear function on the FC, which where of course the point is that just if you've got a point in this union, it's in one of the Z alphas, so you define C on that to just be C alpha. This is well defined because if you had an x in this union that was in two different z alphas, then of course the two different psi alphas would give the same value. So that's fine. So that has a maximal element. So Zorn tells us that Zorn says P has a maximal element, which is some subspace W and some linear functional phi prime. But if W wasn't all of X, then it couldn't have been maximal, because this argument just told us how to always extend things by a little bit. If you can find something that's not in your subspace, you can always extend. And so this W actually has to be X. By the first part, and then we're done. We found our extension. Any questions here about how Zorn is working? Yes, great. X equals, so W equals X is probably the right way, right? yeah, W equals X. Whatever the maximal element is in this crazy partial set, the subspace piece has got to be the whole space, or you couldn't have been maximal. So, it turns out that the Hahn-Banach theorem is not as sad as this proof makes it sound. Because in practice, what do you do? Well, if you want to work constructively, you just keep in mind, oh, I've got my linear functional that I wish I could extend to the whole space, but that requires Zorn's lemma to do, and I can't do that. So you just read through the rest of your proof and work out all of the places, that all of the vectors that you're going to ever apply your extension to, and then just do the finite, the steps of the extension you actually need to do on the vectors you're going to apply the extension to, and you can nearly always just use the honest first half of the proof and avoid needing to construct the linear functional that you're supposed to find everywhere. But that's only if you're sufficiently obsessive. Okay. So we need to prove the complex version now. And this is pretty straightforward. So let phi sub r just be the real part of phi. So here we remember phi was our complex linear functional. And we can just think of this as a real linear functional. Every complex vector space naturally has a real vector space structure. We can just only remember how to multiply by real numbers. And so, of course, we can think of the real part as a real linear functional on the underlying real vector space of X. And so we then let P be the norm of phi itself. Phi was bounded, so that's just some number. Times the norm on X, maybe I should just write explicitly. Okay. Which is a gauge function. And obviously now, phi r of X is less than or equal to p of X, just by definition of the norm of phi. Okay? Here, I guess we're using the fact that the norm of the real part is obviously less than the norm of the complex diagram. Oh. So we can extend phi r by the second version of Hahn-Banach to phi r prime. I wrote x here, and I should have written y. Subspace that we were working. Okay. So extend phi sub r to phi sub r prime on all of x so that we still have the norm of phi sub r prime. We need point guards here. Now we're going to work out how to get back all of phi. And the point is just that the real part of a linear functional actually tells you everything you want to know, because actually remembers the whole linear functional. Okay? Just because, basically just because of this identity, you can always just pull unit complex numbers in and out of phi. So let me just show you how it works. So let's define phi sub I of x. Phi sub r, we put prime on these, I guess, for consistency, minus I x. And then phi prime. So obviously, this guy is still real value, because phi sub r prime is some real value in the functional. But
We've got this, and both phi sub r prime and phi sub I prime are real linear functional, are real linear. So simply phi prime is real linear. So all that we need to do to see that phi prime, why is phi prime complex linear? Well, we just need to check that phi prime of ix equals I times phi prime of x. Okay? But phi prime of ix, let's just plug it into the definition here, that's phi prime r of ix plus I times phi prime I of ix. And what happens? Well, except for a minus sign, that's the same as what we had up here. So that's just minus phi prime sub I of x. And we can look at this and just plug in the definition there for what phi prime I is. That's I phi prime r minus I x. And that's exactly just, and that's what we want. Okay, but minus II just goes away. And you can think of that minus sign as two copies of I, so that's what we have. Okay. Good. And so we're almost there. Maybe let's just say by a similar argument. Phi restricted to it, so phi prime y is still phi. This is basically this idea that the real part of a complex linear functional determines the whole linear functional. So if the real parts agree by construction, yeah, then they're extinction, then the whole complex linear functional still agree. And we finally need to check the norm. So here we do a little bit of a cheat, and so you let theta be the r of phi prime of x, and then you can just calculate as follows. The absolute value of phi prime of x, well, since phi prime is a complex linear function, we can just stick complex numbers in here without changing the absolute value. So that's phi prime of e to the minus I theta times x. But now, of course, this is real. So maybe I should just left e to the I theta outside. Maybe it would be clearer. Yeah, better to read outside. So what I want is the next step is that this is just the so this is real. Yeah, by the definition of theta. So I can just put a real part of here. Now let's move the theta inside. That by definition of phi prime is just phi prime r of e to the minus I theta x, and that then is bounded by the norm of phi prime of r times the norm of e to the minus I theta x, and then that exponential part doesn't matter. Then
and that is what this means here, I think. Sorry. Oh yeah, that's exactly what I put in there. So the phi prime really was bounded with the same bound as our original phi. Okay, yeah, so it's after time. Okay, let me very, very quickly just point out why we need the corollary, and then we can start. So here, the next dual just being bounded linear functionals, we did a few things. So first of all, x dual separates points. So if I give you two points, two vectors in X, we can find a linear functional that takes different values on them. Just by defining a linear functional on the two-dimensional span of those two vectors that takes different values on them, and then extending by a half arc to actually get something in X dual. Maybe more important here is that we can actually calculate the norm of X as the supremum over the absolute value of phi of x, where the supremum is taken over linear functionals of norm 1. Okay? So obviously, everything in this set here is smaller than this number, smaller than the norm of x. And now we can get the inequality the other way. You take your vector x and you just define a linear functional that's defined on that one dimensional span of that vector x, which just takes the vector x to its norm, point of the complex numbers, which is obviously something of norm 1 on that one-dimensional subspace, and then you extend it up to get about a linear functional that still has a norm 1, and so you get this. So this lets us calculate the norm of a vector by looking at all linear functionals applied to it and the absolute values of those. And this factor will turn out to be quite important there. Okay, we should stop there. We'll spend Wednesday and possibly Friday catching up on some stuff we should have done long ago, which is constructing a bunch of examples of Banach spaces, showing that the LP spaces and L infinity spaces really are Banach spaces, and then explicitly identifying what the duals of those Banach spaces are. In particular, we'll show like the dual of LP is LQ, where their conjugate index is 1 over P plus 1 over Q is 1. Okay. It's a Monday after several weeks of, many weeks of no Mondays. Take a break, go do whatever you like. Afterwards, there is a problem set which has a few interesting problems on it. The interesting problem on the problem set for today is to try and work out why a quotient Banach space is still a Banach space, rather than infimum norm really does define something complete. But there are other problems there too. I'm also perfectly happy to talk about questions about the essay, questions about the still upcoming assignment, don't forget the still assignment 4, or indeed about the last assignment. I posted some very partial solutions to assignment 3 earlier today. I'll try and put the rest up at some point. But yeah, I'm happy to do any of that stuff.